In this figure, we want to look at the structures of the thick and thin filaments, the essential proteins that form the sarcomeres. It's important to realize that there are literally billions upon billions of these individual filament structures within a muscle fiber. And so what we have at the top here is a blow up of a portion of the sarcomere. So the sarcomeres go from Z disc down here to Z disc, which we would have another one over here. Right? And from the Z disc, our thin filaments project in either direction. They would actually go this way as well into a sarcomere to the left. Right? We would have thin filaments coming from this one as well on this side. And so anyway, so we're looking at this blow up of the sarcomere, and we can see our thin and our thick filaments. The thin filaments are actin dominated. We'll look at those in a moment. Our thick filaments, suspended by the M-line proteins here in the center, are basically myosin polymers, right? Each individual myosin molecule combines with hundreds of others to form this giant polymer known as the thick filament. And at the bottom here, we've blown up a section here where we're looking at just a small region of the overlap between the thick and thin filaments. And what we see is an individual myosin monomer with its two main components. It has a tail, and it has two heads shown here, right? And it has a hinge in between. And this is important because what's going to happen here is the myosin heads are going to grab and pull on the thin filament when contraction is initiated. Now, that means that the myosin molecule must have a central components here. One of them being, it is an ATPase. It is literally an enzyme that breaks ATP, and it stores that energy in order to pull on the thin filament when activated. It also, of course, has to have an actin binding site so they can actually have a spot to grab onto the thin filament for that attachment to occur, the actomyosin crossbridge to form. Now, if we go to the thin filament, it's a little bit more complicated molecule. It is formed of two F-actin strands, right? The F-actin strands are each formed by multiple G-actins, right? So think of the G-actins as pearls in an F-actin strand, like in a pearl necklace. We actually take two of those F-actin strands and twist them together to form the actin filament. Now, it's even more complex than that because we also have these associated regulatory proteins called troponin, which is a calcium binding protein, and tropomyosin. Now, in the inactive state, the tropomyosin sits on top of the myosin binding sites, right? The reciprocal site that actually binds to the myosin head here. And so that tropomyosin is just in the way of forming cross bridges in our resting state, right? It's blocking the development of tension. During activation, what's going to happen is calcium will be released and bind to our troponin molecule. The troponin associated with the tropomyosin sort of shoves it out of the way, exposing the myosin head binding sites on the G-actin molecule, as we can see here. That allows the myosin heads to sort of grab and then release their stored energy and pull, shifting the thin filament, right? Shifting the thin filament, as seen up here, towards the M-line. That would occur on this side as well, right? We'd have a thin filament suspended in here. Right, pulling towards the thin filaments towards the M line, overall pulling the Z discs at the end of those thin filaments toward the M line, shortening the sarcomere. Right, this happens in sarcomere after sarcomere after sarcomere, sequentially, right, in series in these myofibrils, shortening them overall and generating significant linear tension.